John Shipley had loaned a large part of his collection to for that exhibition. So I'm really delighted that you could write the piece and then spend some time talking to us about it a bit today. So thank you very much. In 1941, and then in 1942 he returns to
it and have it set free in Manchester. And over the next few years, he kind of wandered around taking whatever jobs he could find, and eventually ended up in London in 1946, where he was told that Lucie was looking for potters to help with her studio. So later he was also a refugee who had fled Marxism in 1939, and she was an award-winning potter in Austria who was well established, and she wanted to establish herself in the UK. But obviously the war years were very tough for everyone, and she described them later as cabbage years, because there wasn't much kind of opportunity to feed yourself well, I guess. But she did spot that there was a gap in the market for making buttons for the fashion industry, because all the factories were in requisition for the war effort. And Rhee was also keen to support her fellow emigres, refugees, so she employed a lot of them to help her make buttons. And then Hans Kopert turned up on her doorstep, looking quite ill, weak and thin, and she immediately employed him and began his training to be a potter. So their friendship and mutual respect was really a special kind of thing that they had between them. Lucie famously said she didn't like anyone else's pots apart from her own, but she did like Hans Kopert's pots. When he first started, he was making buttons with all the other workers, and he gained a bit of a reputation for being a troublemaker and kind of joking around and not working hard enough, so she'd often have to kind of tell him off. But at the end of the war, when all the other studio workers left, he stayed on because she was really kind of putting a lot of effort into supporting his work as a potter. And they collaborated on this new, very modern range of tableware. But they were also kind of working on their own personal work as well, and their styles began to diverge in the 1950s. But she was very much supportive of his ambitions to be an artist, to be a sculptor. And he'd always drawn in his spare time, so she encouraged that and saw that there was really promise there. So the early work that he was used was mostly bowls and jugs with linear decoration, but gradually his work became more refined, focusing on form. And his early training in engineering became really useful in that he developed this new style of making ceramics, which was shocking at the time. Although his body's work always started on wheel, he would often then kind of take it apart and cut it, alter it, reassemble bits, exploring shapes and different forms exhaustively. He kept to a monochrome palette, which is meant that people refer to his work as either black work or white work, but actually there's a lot of the colours are much more subtle than that. And their surfaces became much more sophisticated, so they were designed to emphasise the form. And the oxides and glazes were applied and then worked on with great kind of attention and over a long period of time. So that's kind of the idea of the patches of lead to kind of help the balance, so to make sure that once it started going, it would keep going. It's a very kind of technical engineer piece. But it's also a really beautiful piece as well. It's got the remains of clay and the remains of his activity kind of ground into the surface. And also it's got this very strange sponge stuff on a stick, which I've never been able to work out what that's for.
Get the water out of it.
It's attached though, it doesn't come off.
What?
It doesn't come off.
It's not attached to the from them.
Over the last few years since we've had the wheel at York, we've had a few demonstrations by potters. So we had Wally Keeler do a demonstration on it once, and he described it as like wearing another man's trousers. Obviously, been built to Kansas requirements. Of course, you can see Edmund Waldo, because he doesn't resist having a sit on it. And here's I think Hans Cooper was quite tall, but with Edmund it looks like his knees are a bit around his ears. When Wally Keeler demonstrated on it, he had to put some bags of clay on the seat to raise him up enough to be able to use it. As an example of what I was talking about earlier about the aura of Cooper's work and the kind of the effect it has on people. So this is a collector called Alan Firth, who was a great admirer of CoCA and bought about 20 or 30 Coopers in his personal collection that his wife and him collected over the years. And it's just it's really the way he talks about and the way he handled that pot was really quite moving. We'd invited him to do a talk to be filmed on talking about his favourite pot in his main collection and also to talk about the experience of knowing his name. And he chose probably the most important pot in our collection and we'd already committed to taking this pot to his house so he could actually handle it in his own home. And at that time, I think the values of CoCA weren't as sky high as they are now. I think we would have had seven pots today, but it was really nice for him to sit in this living room in this tiny, very inconspicuous bungalow in Leeds. And he's there holding this. Really, really beautifully actually. And it's kind of a reaction that I've noticed in most people when we do lots of handling sessions at the museum store where people can come in and get a bit closer to the objects. And without fail, everyone wants to handle a CoCA. And the first time we did a handling session, this chap asked to hold the CoCA and he sat in a chair and made him sit down. And he sat with this CoCA cradling it in his arms and there was this beaming smile on his face. And he had a picture taken. That's the memory that he is with him to this day. So this is a piece and it's one of the last three that Isney bought in 1975. And he used his retirement lump sum he was retiring as a librarian at the time. I don't know how much his lump sum was, but he managed to spend it on 176 pots that year, which is staggering. And I think this is possibly the most expensive one he bought. It's definitely the most expensive CoCA that he bought, and it cost him £81, which at the time was more than 2 weeks' average salary, so it's quite a big investment. And frighteningly, it was sent to him by the post. And it arrived when he was at work, and the postman seemed this cycladic work was one of the last series of work that CoCA worked on. It was very much a response to the Mediterranean works from dating from around 3000 to 1000 BCE. And figurines from this period are thought to be the earliest representations of the human form. So pieces such as the Venus and Willendorf are described as fertility figures, but there's no real consensus as to what their purpose was, whether they were funerary offerings or idols or toys. Well, these pieces by CoCA represent this extremely stylized pear-backed figure with an extended neck and the shoulders tapering down to the foot. It's thrown in several sections, which CoCA then cut and reshaped and joined together. The base and the top were fired separately, and he made the base section solid and heavy to counterbalance the top of it, so it was very stable when they stand up. Also, he created like a metal cradle for the top sections to sit on. So the very fine pale line, which you can see on the piece, which just looks like a decorative mark, is actually the unfired surface of the clay from the cradle. So, and then he joined the top to the base by drilling a small hole in which and fixing it in with a small section of steel knitting needle. So these are all kind of processes that are a result of his engineering knowledge that he's applying to these sculptural works. Now this is all of the CoCA works in Billy's Lace Collection. They're arranged in chronological order. And during the early years, he bought multiple pieces from the CoCA's shows as an encouragement, because he was, from the conversations that he'd had with CoCA at these shows, he understood that the work was very different and people weren't kind of completely sold on it, so he was afraid that CoCA would stop making if people didn't buy it. So you can see that he's buying multiple works, so five in 1956, five in 1958, and then four in 1965. But by the mid-1970s, the prices began to get too high for his estate, because he'd retired, he only had his pension, he'd spent all his lump sum. So the last three pieces were bought during that year, and then afterwards he would go along to exhibitions and support CoCA, but he wouldn't be able to buy pieces. But they represent a range of scale and size, although you can't really see from this image, but the one that I've highlighted in 1959, that's the largest work, which is about 60 centimetres tall. And it's, Ismay said it was almost identical to the one of the famous pots in the early 1980s, which sold for in excess of four figures, which was the first time that a pot had sold beyond £1,000. Really important record of valuable research resource to kind of understanding how commercial galleries were presenting his work. And other records show exhibitions in Nottingham and at Primavera, a couple of exhibitions at Primavera over the years. And this group of photographs is tells a very different tale actually. It's which again kind of goes back to the power of CoCA's work. The other main collector of CoCA's work, when his name began collecting, was a gentleman called J.M. Dewey Prowler. And he was the biggest competition. He was buying CoCA's at astonishing rates. I think he worked for a local council somewhere as an accountant or something. I think that's his background. But in 1961, his name probably got to know him from bumping into an exhibition. So he arranged to go to Prowler's and photograph the pots that he had. And these are the images. And then in 1960, just a few months later, Prowler's wife, Eva, wrote to him explaining that Prowler had suffered some kind of a mental breakdown and had actually smashed all of his coconut pots. It's just really, even though it's just so shocking, but she wrote that only one of the pots escaped slaughter. She wrote again later after one of the, I think there was a retrospective of Hans Koch, and she wrote to his aftermath saying how sad it was to go to that exhibition and to remember all the pots that had not made it to being in that show. So this image, I think, kind of sums up the value of an archive and that record of activity. So we're very lucky at York to have those really early CoCA pots, but also the record of the ones that are no longer with us. So the negatives were sent to Jane Cooper when they were writing Tony Burke's book, and she printed them off as these contact sheets, and some of them are in the Tony Burke's book. So this is a letter that Lucie Reeve sent to Bill Isley. And again, it's kind of the idea of how powerful his work and how it's not necessarily just a pot, it's something much more strong and spiritual than that. So they were having a discussion about how people would go to Bill's house to see his collection, and then they would have an exhaustive tour of the house, and at the end of the tour they would be offered the opportunity to choose a pot from the collection to drink a cup of tea from, which became known as the Yorkshire Tea Ceremony. And I think one potter requested one of Hans Koch's pots to drink out of. Lucy was amazed by that, but also remembering Crowther's kind of reaction to Koch's pots and how not the thing to do with if you went to Mr. Crowder's house. I want to talk about how I met John Shipley, but first I wanted to mention an international loan of CoCA's work that we did before that. We've loaned ceramics to Japan on a number of occasions over the years, and they were generally Bernard Leach, Shoji Hamada. Classics. And this was the first CoCA exhibition and a major tour of his work to the country, introducing CoCA to the Japanese audiences. We loaned 15 works, which was half of the holdings that we had. They requested all of them, but we decided to be safe and to kind of make sure earthquake precautions, this is a very serious thing with the specially engineered galleries and cases, and the image there shows the technicians carefully tying down the curtains to the top of the case so they don't fall over. And the exhibition had just closed at the Iwate Museum of Art in Morioka in February 2011. And the loans were about to be transferred to Shizuoka Art Gallery in the south of Japan at the beginning of March, and they left literally 1 week before the tsunami hit. So I think that was a kind of reassurance to us that yes, we should be we did the right thing. You know, we're lending half of them. Morioka was one of the cities that was really badly affected. And I think this was a near miss for us in a way, and a stark reminder of the responsibility that we have of curators to CoCA in the collection and to protect it from what may be unforeseen risks for us if it happens. So the Oregon Jewish Museum and Center for Holocaust Education approached us in 2018. Sandy Percival, who was a curator and founder of Sima Zeta, which is an arts kind of organisation in Portland, Oregon. She was a close friend of John Shipley towards the end of his life, and she'd been asked to guest curate an exhibition on Hans CoCA at the museum with John's collection at the centre. And like Japan, they wanted to borrow all of our CoCAs, and like Japan, we said no, we would lend them half. Also, we had one on loan from Anthony Shaw, and he very generously allowed us to be loaned as well. So we began by asking details of how they were to be displayed, questions about cases and security, to establish whether we felt confident that the objects would be properly cared for. Especially after the Japan experience, we were aware that the northwest coast of America had been under the threat of an earthquake for several years, and it would be insufferable that it would happen whilst our really important parts were there. But we agreed to loan the 15 pots. And just talked for a bit about John Shipley. He was born in Berlin in 1927 and emigrated to the USA in 1939 when he was 19 with his parents and his older sister. And they settled in Salem in Oregon. And the family decided that they were settling more quickly if they used an anglicised version of their name. So they picked up a local phone book and selected a name that sounded very most similar to their German name, which was Shibulitsky. And John felt a real sense of kinship with Hans CoCA because of the experience of World War I and the experience of leaving your country and such change. John and his wife Joan began collecting in the 1970s, and one of the first people they went to see was Lucie Reed at her studio. Lucie was in her 70s then and petite, but had a huge force of energy. And she told them that they could choose whatever they wanted to have. It was completely up to them. But they felt very inhibited by her personality and weren't able to make a decision. And one of John's great regrets was missing that chance to buy something directly from Lucie's studio. But they're collecting, he described it as an adventure. When they came to the UK, he wasn't interested in going to see the Shetland Islands or anything like that. He just wanted to hunt for pots. That was the focus of their trips. He bought a lot from Gallery Besson, but complained that Anita kept the prices quite high and wasn't willing to push. So importing them back to the USA. And I think there was, at that time, there was a problem with being charged customs for importing and exporting. And he said that because a COCA has a hole in it, it's described as a utilitarian object, which they're far from utilitarian. And it took one private collector making the effort to go to Washington to speak to people to get that kind of definition changed. So the first time John saw Coker's work was during the Collingwood Coker exhibition at the W&A Museum. It's an old image like stone off the internet on the top left. Was really a crucial person to them when they were first starting out with collecting, and he helped them buy their first COCA, and he advised them on some of his students, different students to look at, because David was the head of pottery at the Royal College of Art, so his students at the time were this Fritsch, Lucie, Madeline, and all the people that are kind of form the collection upstairs. And they also became friends with a chap called Michael, who'd been the head of the British Press Centre. I can't remember his last name.
I
think Michael had just finished at British Press Centre and had moved to Bath, and he was the original owner of the egg pot gallery. And he commented that, John Shipley commented that if there was a fire in his house, that was the thing he would go back and save, this amazing egg pot. But at the time, Michael was renovating an old Irish tavern in Bath, and John had gone to visit him and seen the egg pot on the mantelpiece, and said that, you know, if you ever want to sell that, tell me because I want to buy it. And less than a year later, Michael got in touch with John and said, are you serious? And John made him an offer and then transferred the money over within minutes of being the price. John and his wife Joan went to London quite a few months later, and John carried on up to Bath to collect it and then returned to London on the train. And you can see from the scale of it, I think they wrapped it up in some papers and put it in a little box, or big box. But by the time he got back to London, he was due to meet Joan and his wife at the theatre, and he didn't have time to take the pot anywhere, so he'd had to carry this massive pot into the theatre. And it was in the 1980s, which was right at the height of the IRA situation. So the security at the theatre were very alarmed at this big package walking through the door. Negotiation to get them to let him in with it, and they locked it away in the cupboard for him. And then a few days later, when they were flying back to America, they went through security at the airport, and the pot was x-rayed, and they decided that it looked just like a bomb that would be dropped on Nagasaki. So again, more negotiations before they die on the plane. I got a list of Sandra, who knew John, just outlining the different artists in his collection. This is just a small kind of sample of it. But basically, he was also collecting works by contemporary artists, American contemporary artists and ceramicists as well. So when they went to his house, it's just the kind of difference between the American ceramics and the British ceramics was really quite obvious. But he had all the really important names in his collection at the time. The Patty Warashima, he had loads of Patty Warashima, Peter Longhouse, Ken Vergs, and all the big kind of American studio potters were represented in his collection. The Shipleys had lived in the same house in the hills outside Portland for about 50 years. And it was surrounded by trees and woodlands and kind of deceptively large, all on one level. So you approached it through the trees and it just looked like a little shed, but actually it was a massive space. And when I was there, we had to enter through the side door because there was a bird nesting in the security light, and we weren't allowed to disturb the bird at all, so we went into kind of through the garage and through the side door. But the house was absolutely full of art. The bathroom had a Peter Collingwood hanging up next to the bathrooms and the towels. There were shelves of books in the bathroom as well. And it was just full of stuff. The kitchen was full of baskets and storage pots on top of the units. So it was kind of, it had a comfortable lived-in feel, and it just showed that they really enjoyed living with their collection. There didn't appear to be any hierarchy amongst the belongings, although John said that he counted his coconuts every morning, hoping that there would still be a letter. Mm-hmm. So obviously they had a really special place in his heart. So the last pot by CoCA that he bought was from the Garth Clark Gallery in New York in the 1980s. So he was only collecting CoCA for around 10 to 15 years. And it was kind of, it was definitely an adventure, and it was hard to collect CoCAs because, as Ismay commented to Alice Firth in a letter, he said that Peter Dingley is one of the few contacts who are good enough to get any work from CoCA and Renau. Others are Janet Leach in the St. Ives shop, Marjorie Parr in Chelsea, and John Pike in Nottingham. No one has a regular supply. The only other way to get them is to go to CoCA studio and visit them. So it really was a competition and a struggle to acquire pieces. But back to the Portland exhibition. As the details of the exhibition design emerged, we realised that this was no ordinary exhibition, but rather an artistic installation. So these are some of the mock-up images that Sandra sent me, which, to be honest, filled me with dread. I couldn't imagine us ever being able to agree to learn such kind of special works, important works, to be displayed in such a precarious way. So rather than displaying them in locked cabinets, they were proposing that the objects would be dishonored and displayed in the gallery in a space that was close to the building entrance. They would be placed on these platforms supported by a single leg. So it was only after they sent me the technical drawings and I checked them with our technician that we began to feel a bit more reassured that it wasn't a big kind of a joke. So we kind of felt that the structure itself was safe enough, that the island that they were going to be positioned on was large enough that were out of reach. The metal, the steel structures were really strong and thick, and they were bolted to the platform, which was on top of a concrete floor. So if the worst happened and there was an earthquake, you know, there would be a bit, there was a bit of movement there, but not necessarily enough to topple them, and they would be definitely going down. So we decided that we'd go ahead and we'd let them borrow 15 of our pots plus Angelou's pot as well. So they originally proposed the exhibition to take place in 2020, which is the centenary of CoCA's birth, but as we were at the time we were planning our own CoCA exhibition for 2020, we said that we were unlikely to approve a loan, so they changed their dates to 2019. In hindsight, that was a stroke of luck, because the pandemic in 2020 would have meant that the loan would definitely not have taken place. And it also meant that was the end of our plans for our CoCA show, sadly. But hopefully that will happen eventually. This is the object list. So alongside York's works, there were pieces from John Shipley's collection, and then other loans from the Proper Art Museum, the Ruth Chamber Williamson Gallery at Crooks College, American Museum of Ceramic Arts, Jeffrey Swan Gallery, Pacific Northwest Art, College of Art, and then lots of other private collections. So there are about 40 odd works altogether, and they devise this way of labelling them with a handout, so the images were arranged to reflect where they were on the display. They also included works by Lucie from John's collection, but they were very conscious of the fact that Lucie and Hans Cover are often shown together, and actually they were joined at the hip. You know, they had very different outputs, and you know, the focus of this show was to be CoCA, so the CoCA pots were the definitely highlight, and the museums are kept off to the side where they could be to close more closely, and they were behind glass. But it was important that she was there, because they had such a close relationship, and Hans CoCA said that Lucie was an iron fist and a velvet glove, and Lucie said, "I am a potter and Hans is an artist." Any other kind of new discovery to me as part of that exhibition was the work of Dan Flavin, who is an American conceptual artist, minimalist artist, and in 1990 he made a series of two different lights, neon light works. One was called Untitled Two Hans CoCA Master Potter, and the other one Untitled Lucie Master Potter. So there was a piece of the Hans CoCA work by Flavin which was exhibited as part of the exhibition, which really kind of added a different dimension to how kind of understanding his impact on the wider art world. Lots to unpack and to learn about Hans CoCA. the setup for my Marlborough Fine Arts company commissioned this coat from Copra's a surprise gift for Henry Moore, and Henry kept it in his salon for the rest of his life, where he would entertain the great and good of the art world, and there was a hand coat very, very prominently on display. So there's all these threads and links that we can follow through. The exhibition I hope to put on in 2020 was positioning CoCA amongst the modern art world and following up those threads with all the kind of influence that he was interested in, from Brancusi and Giacometti, the cycladic art, the Egyptian ceramics, all areas which kind of fed into his work and were kind of visible in him. And this is something I only came across a couple of weeks ago when I was doing research for the essay. And it's a card that was written to Alvin Pat Firth by Jane Cope after Cope's death, after Lucy Reed's death. And until then, I had no idea that Hans Cope and Lucy Reed's ashes had been spread together on top of a hill in Somerset, so they'd been reunited. His work and
you said, so you said the pots would move down.
Yeah, there's you can get this it's like a film, a clear film that you can buy. You could surround it and make kind of ideas. And it's like a conservation way.
Okay.
And then there's this other stuff called museum well gel, which is disgusting. you put it on your lovely table and it kind of spreads out and covers everything. It stays wet, so if you use it on the wrong pot, it will soak into the clay. So you can only really use it on a glazed surface.
Oh, I love
that. And then there's the museum wax, which is similar, but it's pink.
Just going to ask, is it recorded what Hans Coca felt of crowd was smashing all those pots? It's an extreme sort of event. And did he say anything about that?
He may well have done, but it's not recorded anywhere. It may have been recorded in some of his papers and then destroyed, but that's the frustration. I know there are people, and there's people like Brooke in Australia who are very close correspondents with Coop because they live so far apart. So I know he has a record of, well, an archive of those letters, but hopefully one day they will become kind of public domain, or maybe get some more insight. But I mean, we've got letters from